Hello, Saint Wenceslaus High School Youth Group. I'm Father Augustine, which I guess you know because you sent me the questions. I'm going to try to answer all of your questions now and pay attention, especially you in the back. Yep, I see you. Quit that. That's rude. Now, how many of you actually looked behind you to see who I was pointing at? All right, now anybody who turned around and looked, everybody gets to point at them and laugh now. Okay, with that out of the way, first question was, this is regard to my book, Humility Rules. Why did you decide to write the book? I guess I didn't really decide to write the book. What happened was the abbot made me the chaplain for our high school. My monastery runs a high school, and it needed a chaplain. About a quarter of the faculty are monks, so there are lots of monks in the school, but my job is specifically to run the retreats and stuff. I also teach English and classics and theology, and I coach rugby. But in any case, he made me the chaplain, and I said, "But I'm a terrible monk." And he said, "Yes, you are. But your heart's in the right place, so I'm going to give you this job." And so every Wednesday, we have a prayer assembly at our high school. And I lead the prayer assembly, and I read a chapter of the rule, and I talk about it. And that's how this book sort of came about. How did I meet Jesus? I said, "Hello, I'm Augustine." And he said, "Hello, I'm Jesus." And I said, "Nice to meet you," is the short answer. The long answer is that, I'll tell you what, I had a student, a really annoying student years ago, whose name was Chris, and he raised his hand in class and he said, "I'm not going to believe in Jesus unless," or he said, "I'm not going to believe in God unless he comes down and personally introduces himself to me." And I said, "Well, he has." And he said, "Is that why you believe in God?" And I said, "Yes, because God personally came down and introduced himself to me." And he said, "Great, okay, what does he look like?" And I said, "Well, he's about 5'11 with dark hair, and he's wearing a yellow t-shirt with the blue eyes on it." And he said, "You're talking about me, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "What's that supposed to mean?" And I said, "Well, Mother Teresa said that you can always tell Jesus because he will come to you in the distressing disguise of the poor. So if you just think of the person who annoys you the most, that person is Jesus. So if you want to meet Jesus, just introduce yourself to someone who annoys you. But don't do it now, and don't let them know you're doing it." Do I think climate change is real? I'll tell you what, I'm not a scientist, so I don't really know, and I don't really care. I know you're not supposed to trash up your backyard, so it's just morally abhorrent to pollute the environment. I'll tell you what, I do tend to think when enough smart people agree on something that is their area of expertise, it's a good idea just to go with what they tell you. I tend to use this theory when it comes to theology. So if enough theologians say that the Eucharist is real, I just go with that. If they say it's a bad idea to get to live with your boyfriend before you get married or your girlfriend, then if enough theologians agree on it, I tend to believe them. So when it comes to all the teachings of the church that I have trouble with, and there are a few, I just tend to say, well, if it was good enough for Mother Teresa, Thomas Aquinas, Duns Scotus, John Paul II, and Cardinal Ratzinger, Pope Benedict XVI, and St. Francis, well, then it should be good enough for me. And if I'm going to be consistent about that, then, you know, most of the scientists in the world, the climatologists, agree that climate change is real. So I'm just going to go with what they say. And in the meantime, I think it's really important just to not trash your home, which is the earth. It's not our earth, so take care of it. All right. How often do I go to confession? how often do I recommend confession? I go to confession. I try to go to confession every week, but I end up going about once every 3 weeks because things, schedules just get mixed up. I recommend going as often as you need. I wouldn't go more than once a week, and I wouldn't go less than once every 2 months. The thing about confession is that it not only takes away your sins or forgives your sins, it actually gives you power to resist sin in the future, gives you superpowers. So there's really good reason to get as much of it as you can. Do you actually personally practice custody of the eyes, as in literally keeping your eyes down? No, I don't literally keep my eyes down. But it is important, and I try largely unsuccessfully to control what I look at. And there are some television shows that, you know, are just not worth looking at, or just not good. They may be worth looking at, but they're not good to look at. Don't know if that works. Anyway, so I try not to watch television shows that will disedify me. I just try to look at things that are beautiful and to avoid things that are ugly. You know, one of the first monks I ever met, I remember asking him, and these were my actual words. I said, "What happens if you're walking down the street and you see a hot chick?" And he said to me, "Well, what I do is I take my scapular and I put it over my head until she passes." And I said, "Really?" And he said, "No, that's absurd." He said, I say, "Thank you, God, for a beautiful woman. Your creation is marvelous. Now I'm going to move on with my life." So that I think is at the core of custody of the eyes. Have I ever been the cellarer? No, I was the kitchen master, but I am far too irresponsible for the abbot to give me the position of cellarer. The cellarer usually has to be somebody who can organize things, keep track of things, keep schedules, and be responsible. And I am really none of those things. How often do I leave what's the hardest part of the rule for you to follow besides being late? Well, the first, second, and third are being on time for things. The hardest part of the rule, well, I gotta say, as much as I love silence, the silence is difficult for me. I tend to want to fill my downtime with hobbies and things. In fact, you can see behind me, I've lately gotten into building armor. I just made that Roman shield and that Viking shield. And in fact, if you look over here, I just built that suit of samurai armor out of old air conditioner parts and scrap leather. Pretty cool, huh? Yeah, anyway. So I tend to move from project to project, and it's important to learn to waste time with God. Hold on, my power source is going out. I have to lick it before I stick it in the computer, because otherwise there it goes. Otherwise the connection doesn't connect. Okay, where was I? Keeping silence is the second hardest. How often do I leave the monastery? I go for weekly allergy shots, so I don't know if that counts. I get 3 weeks of summer vacation with my parents when I go surfing. And now that I'm a big shot famous author, I get to go give retreats and things. But that doesn't happen really all that often. I guess about every 2 or 3 months I'll fly off somewhere and pretend like I'm holy in front of people. But that, like I said, that doesn't happen very often. What's your favorite part about being a monk? I love the habit. I think it's really cool. See, if you put your hood up, then you look like the angel of death, and you can scare little kids. See? Yeah. I really do love the habit. And the English Benedictines have this floppy hood that really looks medieval and cool. I really like hanging out with other monks. That's fun. Monks tend to be pretty interesting kinds of people. And the monks in my monastery are both interesting and pretty smart, and have interesting hobbies. In fact, one of our guys, I was talking to him the other day, and He bought a copy of Dante's Inferno and an Italian dictionary and taught himself Italian. And then he went to Italy last summer, and they all laughed at him because he was speaking 12th century Italian to them. But that's just an interesting guy. I like talking to Father Rafe. But they're all kind of interesting that way. And so I really enjoy hanging out with the other monks. I also just caught the novices. They had stolen one of the maintenance team's golf carts and were joyriding across campus. It was really funny. So I like it. It can be fun just hanging out with the guys. Do you think it'd be boring to not believe there's a bunch of angels and demons around you? Yeah, it would be boring. I think the life of an atheist must be depressing and boring. I mean, they tell me it's not. Most of my friends outside of the monastery are unbelievers. And they seem to enjoy their lives. If you think about it, there's whatever you're doing has multiple layers of meaning if there's this hidden world, this invisible world around you. There's not just the physical and the chemical and the philosophical. There's also this whole spiritual world, atomic world. There's so many layers. I think it would be boring. What was the most difficult time you ever encountered at the monastery? Well, I'll tell you what. We had a guy join the monastery who was an actual psychopath. And he was a terrible liar and really did a lot of damage to the community, sort of grumbling quietly from one monk to the other. And getting rid of that guy was really hard. I won't go into it a lot more, but most of the problems I have, or that our monastery has, are problems we create ourselves. So, if you think about like high school or your youth group or whatever, if there are problems at your high school, it's because you made them. Let's see. Have I ever done my own homework assignments, or do you make your students do the homework assignments from your book? I have not yet had occasion to make my students read my book or do the assignments, but I'll know next year, because I'm making them all buy my book next year. By the way, if go on to Amazon and write a review, because that sells books. So if you want to do me a personal favor, write a review. And put your name in there so I can thank you. Let's see. What's my number one piece of advice for high schoolers who are trying to be holy? Okay. Oh, good. Okay. All right. I've got... Keep all your screens in a public place. Never take your phone or your computer into your room. And never use it with the door closed. I know that sounds sort of bizarre, but that is my number one piece of advice. My number two piece of advice is to drastically limit the time you play video games or use a screen. Read books. Don't be afraid of being bored. That's the sort of secular part. That's the secular advice. As far as holy advice, receive the sacraments as often as you can. Don't rely on your own strength. Go to Mass as often as you can. Definitely never, 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 ever miss Mass on Sunday. The only excuse for missing Mass on Sunday is if you're sick or traveling by ox cart. Okay. Otherwise, go to Mass every Sunday and receive the sacraments as often as you can. So that was my number one piece of practical advice and my number one piece of spiritual advice. I slammed my finger in that window right there just the other day. So that's why my fingernail looks like that. What time in your life would you say was the time when you made the greatest progress in holiness? I guess this is it. I've been gaining momentum over time. The older you get, the easier it is to be holy, I think. I could be wrong on that. No one's ever asked me this question, so I'll have to think about it some more. But for me, yeah, I think right now I'm making the most progress because I know more than I used to know. This is why you should really try to listen to your elders, because they've got more experience. And I wish an older me could have told a younger me all the things I know now so that I could have made this progress earlier. But an older me did. That older me was called my dad. And I didn't really, well, I did listen to him sometimes, but anyway. Do you go by Father Augustine or Father Weta? I go by Father Augustine. It rhymes with disgusting, so that's easy to remember. What is your novel going to be about? Ah, yeah, keep an eye out for that. It's called The Eighth Arrow, and it is a prison, it is a fantasy prison break set in Dante's Inferno. And it stars Odysseus, who, along with his best friend Diomedes, decide they're going to break out. So keep an eye out for that. It's a fantasy novel. The idea is that it's supposed to make Dante and Homer interesting to high school kids. But they want to market it to adults, too. So, who is your favorite saint? Ah, my favorite saint is Blessed Takayama Yukon. He was a samurai. That's why I'm building my armor. In fact, hold on a second. Yeah, that's why I made this samurai helmet. It's in honor of my favorite saint, Blessed Takayama Yukon, Justus Takayama Yukon. He was a samurai, and he converted to Catholicism, and he famous. And then he decided to. I made this myself from scratch, and he decided to defend the local Japanese Catholic converts. And he said, "But from now on, I think he. I can never get the quote right, but he said something like." From now on, instead of using the katana and sword, I will use the words of Jesus Christ. Unfortunately, the words of Jesus Christ weren't quite as effective in practical terms as a katana and sword, and they ended up exiling him to the Philippines, where he died of malaria. But he was pretty cool anyway. So this is my tribute to Blessed Takayama Yukon. Ugh. Made it out of candlesticks and old air conditioner parts and scrap leather. Okay. Ugh. What else we got here? My favorite animal is the Missouri turkey buzzard. And if you ever make it to Missouri, you must find a turkey buzzard. They are the world's most disgusting animals. They are capable of eating food that is so decayed, no other animal in the world will eat it. And they are able to eat this kind of disgusting roadkill and stuff because their vomit is extremely caustic. It's extremely acidic. In fact, it's so acidic that the way they defend themselves is by spraying vomit on things that try to attack them. And the food they eat is so disgusting that they have to vomit on their hands after they finish eating, their claws rather, or whatever, talons, so that it cleans their talons. Otherwise, they would get infections from the very food that they eat. So look up the Missouri turkey buzzard. It's really disgusting. And they're ugly. And they're built so that they can't fly straight. So they're not even graceful. Can I still juggle bowling balls? You know, I've the most, and how many? The most bowling balls I've ever juggled is 3, and I haven't done it in so long. I don't know if I can still do it. The most I've ever juggled is 5, and I definitely can't do that anymore. I got hit in the head so many times playing rugby that my right hand has a permanent tremor. In fact, if you look at this video again, you'll notice sometimes I start doing something like that. Anyway, so my juggling is not as good as it used to be. In fact, I try not to juggle at all. In fact, I hate juggling. little, I did so many children's parties as a young adult for money that I kind of learned to hate juggling. How did I stab myself with a toothpick? I'm not sure. I think when I slammed my fist down on the table, there was a toothpick there. Yeah. How much time did you take to answer these questions? According to this video, I've been at this for 20 minutes. Are we annoying you yet? Yes. If so, see homework on page 151. Arg! You got me. Okay, well, there you go. You see, I should have read ahead. Outsmarted by a teenager once again. Well, thank you for reading my book. Don't forget to write a review. pray for me, though. That's more important. That's the most important thing. I will pray for you, and I'll and God bless you all, and amen. Now, how do I turn this off? There's the button. Goodbye.